Your mission, Patrick Beja, should you choose to accept it, is to host this Daily Tech News show with me for 30 minutes and free Jenny from the logo box in which she is trapped.
I don't think I'm up to it. I'm gonna not accept.
Take
what
this.
What happens then?
You'll need it.
No.
It's dangerous to go alone. I already have a bigger one. Look.
Hey, that's what it's good. Patrick said just now. Literally. All right. Whoa, iPad went to sleep. Wake up, iPad. You're upside down. Doesn't even know which way is up. All right. Ready to go?
Maybe it's from Australia.
We have a special audio intro just for you today, Patrick. I pretend like I didn't play it for him already and get approved. Here we go.
5, 4, 3, 2. The Daily Tech News Show is brought to you by people with ridiculous French accents. And Patrick Beja, who has a remarkably good French accent. Join our Legion at dailytechnewsshow.com/donate or the subreddit at dailytechnewsshow.reddit.com. Now, Thomas, il est temps. Pêcher la vache.
This is the Daily Tech News for Tuesday, September 23rd, 2014. I'm John Merritt. I'm just recovering, Patrick, from Big Jim's introduction. That is apparently a French accent, but you took some prodding to recognize it, I hear.
Well, I guess I knew, obviously, that it was a French accent because it was said in the email accompanying the recording. So do you want to hear a real French accent, Tom?
Sure. Well, yeah, obviously.
I can do a French accent very well, and we can do the whole show if you want like this. It would give a certain je ne sais quoi, a flair to the episode.
Yeah. I don't know what that would do. but, je ne sais quoi.
Thank you very much to Big Jim for the intro. Yeah. I feel honored to elicit such skillful parody. So thank you very much.
If you were to guess what accent that was, where would you guess?
Somewhere in Kentucky, I guess.
Oh, come on, Kentucky. You obviously don't know American accent. All right, no, thank you, Big Jim. That was a lot of fun. And now to the headlines. GeekWire reports on former Microsoft chief software architect Ray Ozzie's new service called Taco. Not luncheon options, sadly. It's with an L, T-A-L-K-O. It lets users do things to voice calls, like tag them or bookmark certain moments, record parts or all, share those parts or all that are recorded, share your tags. Users can also share text messages and photos through the app during a call. It can even do clever things like let you exchange recorded voice memos and then seamlessly turn that into a live call if you want. Ozzie co-founded Taco with Matt Pope and Eric Patey. The app is free to use and out first for iOS.
I usually I'm comfortable loving or hating something, and this one I'm not sure.
I have to try it, right? Because I trust Ray Ozzie. I know he makes some pretty amazing things in his career, like Lotus. Okay, forget that. but this sounds like it could be the kind of thing where I'm like, wow, this has really changed the way I use voice. But it's kind of hard to wrap your head around without using it, I think.
For sure. During his annual competition report to the European Union's Committee on Economic and Monetary Affairs, Joaquin Almunia officially acknowledged that his department has asked Google for more changes to their proposed search settlement. At issue is that Google favors its own services in search results. In February, Google proposed several changes, most significantly displaying three competing services next to its own. Opponents complained that the proposal did not do enough to mitigate Google's dominant position in the EU marketplace.
We're going to dig into this a little bit later on in the show. Ars Technica reports the United States Federal Trade Commission has filed a civil lawsuit against Butterfly Labs, aka BFL, alleging fraudulent and deceptive practices. The feds believe that BFL's founders spent millions of dollars on saunas and guns while failing to deliver promised Bitcoin mining equipment. It's pretty much just like the scams pulled off in San Francisco in 1849. Well, yeah, we'll send you your mining equipment. Meanwhile, saunas and guns!
CNET reports Microsoft has set September 29th as the new date for the launch of the Xbox One in China. In compensation for the delay, pre-order customers will receive two free games. Microsoft will be the first game console maker to launch in China since the ban on game consoles was lifted. The Xbox One will cost 3,699 RMB, that's $600, without Kinect, and 4,299 RMB, that's $700, with Kinect. China is a really huge market, and being there first, even though the prices are very high, there is a very large rising middle class in China, and that could be interesting for Microsoft.
And given Xi Jinping's kind of crackdown, not on a lot of things, but specifically giving the administration has been putting some roadblocks in front of Apple and Microsoft, this got resolved a lot quicker than I expected. I thought this would drag on at least through October. Remember that TechCrunch reported yesterday that Apple was going to shut down the Beats music service. Well, the New York Times reports Apple spokesman Tom Neumeyer said, quote, "This is not true." That's an uncharacteristic flat denial from Apple. Hell, it's an uncharacteristic comment on anything from Apple there.
To be honest, it's a fairly uncharacteristic, straightforward response to any request for comment on anything for any company.
Yeah. Well, I guess you're right there, yeah.
I think they wanted to say no, but they thought that was a little bit too short.
That was too
terse. So they had to, you know, to pretty it up a little bit.
This is not true. What do they mean by that? Those four words. Let's overanalyze.
Let's look at the font and the background.
Probably what's going on here is that Apple does have a plan to change the Beats branding for the music service to iTunes. I said that yesterday, and I still believe that today. And that would allow Neumeyer to say, this is not true. We're not shutting down Beats. Because otherwise, why do they put the Beats app on Apple TV? I just don't see them letting that happen. That's not Apple's style. So I don't know. Yeah. I think there's more to the story.
Yeah. Android Police reports Microsoft announced a wireless display adapter that fits in the back of your TV or monitor and mirrors content from any Miracast-enabled device. For $60, you get a little black cable with the HDMI on one end and USB for power on the other. That will let you mirror Miracast-enabled devices' screens.
Okay, so cool.
It's a $60 Chromecast kind of, except it's Miracast.
It's almost twice the price of Chromecast, and then arguably either more functional because it just does straight mirroring, which Chromecast doesn't do. Chromecast does some mirroring in certain cases, or it's less functional because it doesn't have the app ability to send video to the device and then still let you surf the device that you're sending from, you know, because you're just doing screen mirroring. Yeah. The Verge reports PayPal has partnered with Coinbase, BitPay, and GoCoin to process Bitcoin payments for some merchants in North America. If you sell intangible items like music, ringtones, and the like through the PayPal payments hub, you can accept Bitcoins now.
Cool.
Yeah. Although PayPal's not processing themselves, so they haven't accepted Bitcoin into the PayPal womb yet.
It was disturbing how you said that. The next web reports that Jola's Sailfish OS phone is on sale in India now through snapdeal.com. Jola has been selling the phone in Europe through its own site since December. Customers in India will pay 16,499 rupees or $270 if they want to pick one up. Two things, I guess. First of all, rupees always makes me think of Final Fantasy, and I was certain it was the Final Fantasy money until I realized it was actually, you know,
like a real currency.
And so that's the phone and the OS created by the ex Nokia guys, right?
Yes, the Migo folks who left Nokia went off and created. Now, did you ask your wife how to pronounce this? Because I've heard Yola.
Yes, it is Yola. But
is it all right?
Everyone is saying Mojang for Mojang.
Well, Notch has even said, if you're speaking English, say Mojang. If you're speaking Swedish, say Mojang.
Or he's got billions of dollars. He doesn't care about anything at this point.
So I don't know. Anyway, yes, this is
Yola.
This is them. That's who we were talking about.
Excellent. We've settled that. We can move on.
Time for
very
some
important
news.
Tech topic.
Right, right. Time for you would be surprised. Like, I bet 20% of my email is about pronunciation. Time for some news from you. These are things submitted at our subreddit, dailytechnewsshow.reddit.com. If you haven't joined in, go join in the fun. There's more than 3,000 people in there voting things up, voting things down, submitting stories, submitting articles. It definitely informs how we put the lineup together every day. And Alan Char submitted an article. The Wired report that AT&T is offering a new bundle for $39 a month that includes 45 megabit per second internet, HBO, and basic cable. Now, that alone might sound similar to the Comcast and Time Warner Cable HBO basic packages. However, there is more. AT&T also includes 1 year of Amazon Prime, which gets you the instant streaming video, the Kindle lending library, and the free 2-day shipping. Take that, Comcast. Yeah. You got any Amazon Prime in there, do you?
The most important thing for me in all of this is the 45 megs per second internet, which is a very good connection, but isn't there a catch there? It's if you can get that kind of speed, which I'm guessing not a lot of people can in the U.S.
Well, you have to have the AT&T U-verse service available in your neighborhood. I can't get this package because I don't have it in my neighborhood. So it's not universally available. It's a good point.
TM204 passes along an Engadget report that Google Now has a new card in the deck. If you search for a plane ticket in Google Flights, Google Now will slip you a flight price monitor card to keep you updated as prices change based on your recent destination or itinerary searches. Android Police notes that searching for flights on major travel sites like Orbitz or Kayak does not trigger a Google Now card.
Kind of like that.
And anti-competitive concerns there, anyone?
Yes. Siri should be allowed to voice her opinion in your Google Now cards. Alan A.V. passes along the Wired article about four MIT students going to court to defend against a subpoena demanding the source code of a project called Tidbit. It's a tool that was created for the Node Knockout Hackathon, designed to let website visitors voluntarily use their computers to mine bitcoins in exchange for going ad-free on a website. The New Jersey Attorney General claims the programmers violated New Jersey computer crime laws and demanded the source code and details of its users' bitcoin wallets. The code was actually never fully functional, though it was made available for download. MIT has stepped in and asked for the subpoena to be withdrawn, and the Electronic Frontier Foundation is aiding with the defense. I haven't found a good reason why New Jersey is subpoenaing this. I'm not sure what actual criminal charges they think could be levied, but they haven't charged them with anything. It's only part of an investigation, and these guys aren't even in New Jersey.
But it applies if you're using the browser, then you can visit any sort of site from anywhere. And I'm wondering if it's not one of those tampering with computer, very wide-reaching legislation where you're actually changing the web page. So in a way, it could be said that you're tampering with the server that's serving. I mean, I really don't know, but that's the only one that I could.
My guess is that they have a suspect of some sort who happened to have downloaded the Tidbit app, and that led them to just be like, get as much information on Tidbit as you can. Let's see if we can get any more on this guy, because that's kind possibly of the that's been the trend, is cast your net as widely as possible for data. Don't worry about snagging innocent people in its wake.
Well, they still have to make a case for the reason why they're doing that procedure. What's the law that Tidbit is breaking?
Yeah. That's going on in court right now, so I'm sure we'll figure out more in a little bit. That is a look at the headlines. All right, let's talk about the EU. The VP for the committee responsible for competition policy, that's Joaquin Almunia, in an annual competition report to the Econ Committee, that's the EC's Economic and Monetary Affairs Committee, said that some of the 20 formal complaints against Google have given us fresh evidence and solid arguments against several aspects of the latest proposals put forward by Google. And he said at the beginning of this month, we let Google know that. We're waiting for them to respond. This is a change from February when Almunia said, I believe that the new proposal obtained from Google after long and difficult talks can now address the commission's concerns. So he has bowed to the pressure of the Microsofts of the world, of the other search engines that have been pushing for stronger punishments, fines, and restrictions on Google in Europe. Here's what Google had proposed back in February, Patrick. I want to lay this out, and then I want to lay out some of the objections that have come up over the past month, and then you and I can make our best opinions about whether we think Google has done enough or should do more or shouldn't do anything. Google's proposal back in February was that they would have results from three competitors show up alongside its own services. There'd be a label on the Google services. They would be separated from search results. And those links from the rival services would be comparable. Now, on a search engine where the links would just be services that Google provides for free, like Maps, nobody would have to pay anything. However, on a shopping search engine that Google does, links from competing shopping services would have to pay to have the privilege of showing up in those top three links. So it's not as clear cut as, oh, we'll just always put three up there. Somebody's got to pay in some of these cases. There were also several other lesser publicized agreements, new rules on using website content in vertical search services, basically allowing people to opt out easily from the vertical searches like shopping and maps and reviews and things like that, allowing AdSense customers to place ads on sites from multiple providers rather than restricting them and saying, hey, if you put AdSense up, you can't use anybody else, and changes to the API to make it easier if you have multiple ad services to administer them from one interface. The objections to the Google proposal, Microsoft says that tests showed that even if Google did this, and they used Bing as their testbed, they said, we're going to take the provided services from the company, and we put them in one area, and then we put some competing services, and traffic still went to the preferred services of the host. They say that if Google did this, the Google services would still get most of the traffic. In fact, users 99 times more likely to click on Google services. A couple other studies out there, travel company ETTSA argued that Google would earn 330 million euros selling those promoted links, those three competitive links in those situations where they can charge. And they don't think that's okay. That's just a revenue boost for them. And then computer scientists at Hamburg University found that 27.5% of clicks stayed within Google Shopping when they were presented with Google links next to competing links, whereas 7.7% of the clicks went to rivals. And there's also some rumors out there that they want YouTube results to be covered here, that they want data display covered, you know, things like just facts, not just search results. Essentially, they're saying even if these remedies go in place, Google will still have a dominant position in the search marketplace in Europe. Patrick, what do you think?
That is a very wide question, and one that's very difficult to answer in a concise manner. Basically, when you look at
Google's meant about proposal, this issue.
Oh, sorry. Okay, my bad. Then in that case, it's very easy. I thought about going there as I was saying it, but then I figured you have a serious show here. We're running a business. So Google's proposals, when you look at them, in isolation, they seem very reasonable. They seem like they would address the EU's and the competition's concerns. It's like, okay, you're displaying links from competitors and you're doing all of these things that I'm not quite sure how Google could do more than this in order to benefit the competition in this situation. Then you look at the tests, which might be a little bit skewed because obviously Microsoft is doing the tests. I think we might need, in this case, a more neutral entity to do these kinds of tests and see if they would work or not. But when you look at the test results, you're thinking, Well, the initial proposal seemed fair, but if it's not working, then it might not be as fair as we think. And more importantly even, it doesn't solve the problem. And I think that's the key thing to remember in this issue and in this debate. It's very easy to go over this problem and think, well, you know, the EU is bashing Google over the head. Google's being reasonable. It's not their fault that they have such performing services that they're so good that everyone wants to use them. But the thing you have to remember is that when you have a service that occupies so much of the market, then it's not about fairness anymore. The competition is in jeopardy, and you have to apply a different set of rules. Now, I'd like to go over just two numbers to illustrate that the reason why Google is under such immense antitrust scrutiny in Europe. In the US, Google's market share, those numbers are from last year, 2014, but Google's market share was 68%. Now that's still enormous, but there is room for the competition. In France and in Europe, Google's market share is 94 to 95%. That is an unbelievable number. It means that businesses, web pages, all the internet, which is basically everything, because everything goes through the internet nowadays, is completely beholden to Google with almost no alternative. Now, we might discuss for hours whose fault it is and if the competition is not good enough and all of that. It doesn't change the resulting situation, which is Google has an immense majority of the market here. And that is definitely a problem where, again, fairness sort of gets out of the picture, and you have to re-inject somehow, forcefully, possibly, the competition that is very important for an effective open market and capitalistic approach to the market. I think it's also important to remember the Microsoft trial that took place in Europe. It lasted like 15 or 16 years about Windows antitrust issues. And that took a long time, but it was also a lot less difficult to solve. Basically, a number of things were bundled into Windows, and because they had to be, like a browser and a media player and things like that. But ultimately, the way it was solved was that Microsoft would offer the choice to the consumer to install to install competitors' browsers.
Yeah,
exactly. And they had silly things like a Windows Media Player less Windows version, so you had the same Windows version without Windows Media Player that you could get if you wanted. But it was, even that was very complex at the time, but it was a lot more simple. Here, the crux of the issue is, what exactly do we want Google to do? And I don't think, for all the complaining and laying out of the issue, explaining of the issue, I don't think anyone's come up with an exact answer to what we want Google to do. A lot of people are talking about the fact that the algorithm is very obscure. And some EU members are saying Google is favoring its own services in the search results. And of course, Google is saying, no, we're not. We're just using the neutral algorithm. But of course, the only way to resolve that question would be to take a look at the algorithm, which Google is probably never going to let anyone do. So I've been talking for 15 minutes. It's a very complex issue. And I started out with a very anti-EU stance on this. This was almost going to be a rant. Now, having looked at it a little bit more, I'm not sure there's an easy solution or even a bad guy in all of this.
Yeah, I mean, as far as the report goes, I mean, you can look at that report from Hamburg and basically say, okay, well, that's not Microsoft doing it. That's some researchers. And maybe they have their own axe to grind, but 27.5% clicks stayed with Google Shopping, 7.7 went to rivals. That makes sense. Right. The question is, what would be fair, right? If I'm on Amazon and I see two products And one is like available through Amazon, and the other is available from a third party. And Amazon does this. They link out to other people where you can buy stuff. Even if the price is a little cheaper with the third party, I'm more likely to stay with Amazon because I know and trust Amazon. So that's my problem with this is, well, of course you're going to have 27% stay with Google. They're at Google. They went to Google because they like Google, and so they're going to stick with Google. And this is the problem with how do we decide what's fair, right? Your most compelling fact, I think, in everything that you said was that Google has a 98% share in the EU. I think people don't realize that. Even within Europe, they probably don't realize just how predominant. That, if you define a monopoly as more than 50% share, that is ridiculous super monopoly, right? The question is, what would be fair? How do we get this back to fair? And I don't think fair is an equal number of clicks, because Bing would not agree to that. Bing wouldn't say, well, all of your clicks have to be equal as well. Nobody would. The question is, how do you remedy the marketplace so that people actually realize that there are choices? Is it just that Google serves the European market so well that everyone else sucks? I don't think that's true. But how did they get to this dominant position in the first place? It's different than Microsoft. With Microsoft, you bought a computer, it had Windows in most cases. And when it had Windows, you used IE. That's just the way it was. With search engines, people have more portability. Most of them are buying Windows and probably in a lot of cases, at least in the United States, choosing IE. Maybe this was caused by the fact that the EU now has a ballot where they can choose Firefox, they can choose Chrome when they install a Windows machine, and suddenly they're using browsers that Google is the default search engine. Maybe Google shouldn't do anything with their actual search results. Maybe they should go after the market share problem and say, hey, guess what? Google, you can't be the default search engine on all of the browsers anymore.
That could be actually a very interesting, at least, thing to explore, because you're talking about fairness, and as I was saying earlier, I'm not exactly sure. I think we're talking about the same thing, but I wouldn't call it fairness. At this point, I think it would need to be effectiveness. What would even work in this situation that is very difficult to untangle? And the effectiveness aspect is what irks me the most, because Google is giving different types of different proposals and going farther and farther into things that do seem kind of fair, but ineffective. And what irks me, and that was going to be my rant, is that the EU is saying, no, that's not enough. Make another proposal, but not saying what they want to get. So it's a very dysfunctional relationship where they're putting Google in a very difficult position by asking something without even knowing what that thing would be.
I think it's a mistake to ask Google to change how they do their business to fix this. Yeah. Because it's Google's website. Google should be, if you go to Google, you should get what Google thinks you should get. And then the free market should allow you to say, you know what? I don't like that they're shoving their stuff in my face all the time. I'm going to choose another search engine. So the problem is, why are people not moving to other search engines more often? And that's the problem I think they need to solve for. Not make Google send people to other search engines. That is putting the cart before the horse. Because the problem isn't the search results, right? The problem is, and I'm going to use this example. It won't work for you. I actually tried it on google.fr. If you do Chipotle, which is a restaurant chain in the United States, you get a search result for Chipotle at the top, right? That's an unpaid search result. But then before you get the rest of the search results, you get four reviews. They're all Google reviews. They're not Yelp reviews. They're not Foursquare reviews. They're Google reviews. Over to the right, you have a little info box with a Google map in it and Google reviews below it. This is what people are objecting to, is like, hey, wait a minute. If this is just a search engine, now they're sending everybody within to their own Google results. There's only one link on this above the scroll here that doesn't go to a Google thing. So I looked at Bing. They do exactly the same thing. You get Chipotle, then you get Bing local reviews underneath that, and then you get a Bing map to the right. And that's why I'm like, don't make Google change. This is actually the way people want to use the service. Because if you go to ask.com, they do the same thing, but they use Yelp reviews because a review service. So they're using a third party that they made a partner with. Again, the problem, what you should be solving for is letting people choose. Let the company do what the company does and let people have a choice between search engines. And if you have 98% market share, something is impeding that choice, I would argue.
Yeah, it's possible. I'm not saying it's not. But I would come back to the fact that once you get into an antitrust situation, you can't consider the company or the service that has an enormous market share in the same way that you do everyone else. And that's why I think in this case, it could be a good solution or a necessary solution to have Google change the way they do things. I'm not saying it is, and I think it irks me very much to have to get into Google's own search results and change things, but maybe that's the only solution. And because of the antitrust factor, it might be okay, but maybe that's my,
I don't think they've considered other solutions because the pressure is coming from search engines who are like, hell yeah, we want our links showing up in Google. That's exactly what we want for free, right?
And the default analog would be
having Microsoft solve the Windows domination problem by putting other operating systems within Windows in virtual form. Like that just doesn't make any sense at all.
Yeah, I'm not sure it doesn't make any sense because it's not the same situation, I would say. But I will agree with you that the root of the issue, or at least one thing to explore, would definitely be making Google not the default search engine everywhere. That could be something that could be very easily addressed, and that would make a lot more sense and would have, I'm certain, very immediate results. So if Firefox didn't have Google as the default search engine, for example.
And Firefox is like, no, that's all the money. That's where we get all our money.
That's how we get money.
Right? So it's a thorny issue. And I agree with you that we don't know what the solution here is. But I don't think the proposals that even Google has agreed to make actually solve the problem. I actually think Microsoft and friends are right. It doesn't solve the problem. But I don't think anybody's put forth a solution that actually solves the problem because I don't think they're addressing the right problem. All right. We haven't solved anything either, so I'm not going to exempt us from this as well. But let us know. feedback@dailytechnewsshow.com if you think you have the solution. Our calendar shows that tomorrow, September 24th, is BlackBerry's See the Bigger Picture event in Toronto, London, and Dubai. So you'll get to see the new big BlackBerry phone. Tomorrow is also the start of DerbyCon, a meeting of security professionals in Louisville, Kentucky. That runs through the 28th. And today, in 1889, 125 years ago today, Fusajiro Yamauchi founded Nintendo Kappei in Kyoto, Japan, to manufacture Hanafuda, Japanese playing cards, and then later Mario. But starting with playing cards.
I'm wondering if Hiroshi Yamauchi, who was Nintendo's president for a very long time, at least in my time, unfortunately, he passed away in 2013. I wonder if he was a direct descendant of the venerable
I did not research that question, but I would guess likely so, yeah.
Interesting.
Our pick of the day comes from Vance McAllister, known Google lover, who says, if iPhone and iPad users want to get tastes of Android's upcoming material design aesthetic and get a great news app, try out Google Play Newsstand, which was released in the App Store today. This replaces the older Currents app and is a huge improvement. You can select which categories of news you want and can customize the sources feeding into it. For me, it has replaced Feedly altogether, and I'm also using Flipboard a lot less as well. This is one Google app that works well as a standalone, even if you are not in the Google ecosystem, fast and nicely designed. And that's why I call Vance a Google lover, because he's not just a fanboy. He's recommending an iOS app for you, and he follows this stuff. He knows this stuff. So check it out. The Google Play Newsstand is the new name for Currents on iOS. And folks on Android have had this version for a while. But now you get the material design over there on iOS, which is kind of interesting as well.
Yeah, I wasn't going to check it out because I checked it out a long time ago and I didn't love it when it was Currents. But yeah, you've convinced me. Thank you.
Good job,
Vance. Thank you very much, Vance.
Send your picks to feedback@dailytechnewsshow.com and you can find my picks at dailytechnewsshow.com/picks. In fact, I ordered some coffee from one of my picks just this morning, Mistobox. Finally, our message of the day comes from Russell. He was referring to our Oculus Rift discussion yesterday, and it reminded him of a really great book called Ready Player One by Ernest Cline, which was published a couple of years back. Russell describes the story. It's a dystopian future, centers around a virtual space called Oasis, and the outside world has become a place of some misery as the population spends their quality time in a gigantic MMO called Oasis, using an Oculus-style VR device, including the gloves discussed on yesterday's show. He goes on to talk about Wade Watts, the story's main character. There's some Will Wheaton references, a Cory Doctorow reference in there. It won the 2012 Prometheus Award. The Audible version is read by Will Wheaton, so you got to check this out if you haven't already. ReadyPlayerOne.com, or just look for it at your favorite source of books and audiobooks. Thanks for the reminder, Russell. Yeah, Ready Player One is a great predictive story in lots of ways, because it's pointing down the road from Ultima through Warcraft to Oculus of where we might end up. I'm not saying we'll end up in a dystopian society, but the technology that he described is really interesting.
It's been recommended to me on several occasions, so I will have to read it at some point.
You really, really will like it. I'm almost certain. You know, you sometimes don't like things that other people like, but I think you'll like this.
I do. I'm
remembering many movie-licious conversations suddenly, but I still think you like it. Patrick Beja, Le Rendezvous Tech, and of course, regular contributor here on Daily Tech News Show. Hey, where should folks best follow you? Is it not Patrick on Twitter?
It's probably not Patrick on Twitter, indeed. I do a couple of French language shows, but for now, let's keep it to not Patrick on Twitter if you want to have more of my ramblings. And I'm sure that by the time I actually leave my real job at a large computer game company, I will have more to contribute in many different forms and languages. So keep your ears on the ground, is the expression. And for now, not Patrick on Twitter.
Excellent. And thanks to our patrons, 4,288 folks out there willing to give a little value back for the value they receive from the show. We super appreciate it. If you find some value in the show and you're willing to give some value back, dailytechnewsshow.com/donate is the place to go. A couple people recently just upped their contributions out of nowhere. You guys are the best. That is not necessary, but incredibly appreciated. We've got some new milestones we're going to be adding in there as well. I let the patrons know a little bit about that. So more news on that to come. dailytechnewsshow.com/donate. Don't forget, you have a voice in what stories we cover. Subreddit is dailytechnewsshow.reddit.com. Email address, feedback@dailytechnewsshow.com. Phone number is 512-59-DAILY. And you can listen to the show live at mobile.alphageekradio.com, 4:30 p.m. Eastern, 1:30 p.m. Pacific. And our website is dailytechnewsshow.com. We'll be back tomorrow with Brian Brushwood as our guest. See you then.
This podcast is part of the Frog Pants Studios Network. For more information about this and other shows, visit frogpants.com. Audio program so good, it's like you're there.
Yay!
Wasn't there an iPhone 6 review post show thing?
Yes, I'm going to put that in the audio version post because it's 2 minutes long. So there's one of those things, video viewers, that you got to go to the audio podcast to get if you want to hear Anthony's iPhone 6 review.
The other exciting thing about Ready Player One is that it's going to be a movie.
Mm. Oh, is it? It is?
Yeah.
Yep. Which it's optioned.
It has a writer now, Zach Penn. Okay. And the awesome part of that is he has a credit on The Avengers, although we all know who really wrote The Avengers, but it's fine. And I'm sure they've hired a team of rights gatherers.
So it's definitely going to happen.
No, they don't have a director or a cast or anything. But let me tell you something. The world wants this movie.
We're slightly closer to it. Definitely going to happen.
It's going to happen. Sometimes you just have to have faith. And this is one of those times. Would you like some titles?
Let's.
Okay. Saunas and Guns.
Kind of writes itself, doesn't it?
Trust Us, Europe. One that's too long, but it's a little, it's search engines, InfoSeek, AltaVista, Ask Bing, Hotbot, Lycos, Yahoo. I do like Don't Get Your Bing in My Google. That's a good one.
Sounds like a 1940s dance song.
Yeah. Don't put your Bing in my Google.
I'm looking over a Bing in a Google. Remember, it's my Bing.
Okay, that's getting really creepy now.
A torch song about search engines.
We have no Bing Lycos. We have no Bing Lycos today. Yahoo!
Nice.
I don't know. It's up to you. What do you think?
Guns and saunas. Saunas and guns.
Saunas and guns. All right.
Yeah, seems like
the Todd Whitehead original.
Ready what is? Someone's having a party in the street.
What?
I don't know. There's some loud music in my neighborhood.
Oh.
I'm unhappy.
Do you know that I've never agreed to the terms of service of iTunes on this computer?
I just accidentally launched it,
and it said, agree to the terms of service. I'm like, no. I refuse.
I will not.
You can't make me Apple. Although apparently the M4A is still set as a default play in iTunes, so I should probably change that.
Is there also a Ready Player One game like called Stacks? Is this possible?
I don't think so.
There was one when the book came out. They had their own game out.
It says Ready Player One, the Stacks game download available Monday, May 26, 2014. After a year and 2,000 hours of development, the Stacks is ready to play. Go figure.
All right, guys, I'm going to jump off.
All right,
Patrick,
man.
Lovely show. Thank you for explaining things to us. It was great.
Thank you for agreeing to listen to me rant for 15 minutes.
Yeah, it was good stuff, man, as always.
You should read Ready Player One. Excellent. Do it.
I will. Thank you, chat room. You are all champions in my book, even though that's not Ready Player One. And bye, Jenny. Bye, Tom.
Bye.
Bye, Patrick. Au revoir.
Huh. Look at this game. Very, very simple game. Oh, man. Every once in a while, I wish that I hadn't read Ready Player One so that I could read it again.
It's that kind of book.
That kind of book. Although, you know, there's so much in there. You could just reread it every year and find something new.
And if you haven't done, I don't know if you've done the audiobook, but anybody who hasn't done the audiobook then should go do the audiobook because it's read by Will.
That's true.
And he's a great narrator. Every audiobook I've ever listened to narrated by Will Wheaton is fantastic.
Cool.
Have you listened to one?
I have not. I'm not a big audiobook person.
Well, that's a way for you to re-experience the book.
Yeah, that's true. Although I have this dream, although it's basically an illegal dream, I've mentioned this before, of getting all my friends to record a chapter of The Lord of the Rings, and just so I can have it. Like, it's not for sale. It's just for me. You know, because I love hearing it. Lord of the Rings is one of those books that you have a whole new appreciation for when you read it out loud, which has been done in our household over the course of 4 months. It took 4 months to read all three books. So that's my dream.
Is it your primary dream?
No.
Well,
my primary dream involves like cheesesteaks and games and Mexicola.
How is your adventurer?
Oh, in Skyrim?
Yeah.
Oh, it's going very well. I have noticed that I'm old and my eyes hurt, so I can't really play 8 hours of Skyrim anymore or any video game. But it's stunningly compelling. Because I basically had to spend no time learning the controls because it's the same as Fallout. So, I'm like way in the beginning stages. But it's kind of awesome. Then I have to figure out what game is next. What game is next, chat room? Oh, that's a good idea. Atticus what? Minch.
What is
getting Will Wheaton on DTNS?
Yeah, he's
challenge
busy. accepted. We should ask him. We should ask him. I don't think I've ever asked him for DTNS, but usually he very nicely explains that he's like crazy
mega
busy.
Yeah.
And I totally understand, but I'd love to have him.
All right. Let me see what I can do.
We could talk scotch and Guinness and hockey and tech.
Let's see.
All of the things of life.
My question is, what's going to be the game that gets me to buy a PlayStation 4? Because nothing has yet compelled me to do so. I don't feel this need to upgrade.
I don't have a feel for what your particular thing is.
Fallout, Skyrim, open world, massive, character-based, unrestricted as humanly possible.
Well, you might like Destiny, actually. You should try Diablo, although that's not PS4 specifically. Diablo 3, Diablo 3 for the console, wide open, fantasy, open world,
okay,
character-based, lore, lore out the yin-yang.
Lore is good, lore is good. There's so much lore in Skyrim, I'm like, my eyes are
I hadn't even thought about it before. You would love Diablo.
Okay.
Especially because I don't get the feeling that the mechanics of the character of the fighting are what, you know, are important to you. Like some people are like, I don't like Diablo because you're not doing as much first person shooter fighting. And right. I don't think that that would matter. I think you'd
No, I like less first person shooter fighting.
I think you'd love it.
Well, I'm not such a big fan of these dragons. Getting a little out of hand.
Dragons?
Yeah. Uncharted 4, would I like Uncharted 4?
I don't know. I don't really play those games, so yeah. I have a harder time on that side. Maybe, if you like 5, I mean, they're generally in the same category.
All right. I like that. Really, the answer is what games Jenny should play is no games. No games. No more games. But... I gotta keep my skills.
That's a horrible idea. No more games. Yeah, what are you talking about? Who said that?
I don't know. But yeah, I gotta keep my skills up because Oculus is coming. Hey, when we all get Oculus Rifts, can we do a virtual show inside like an Oculus Rift verse?
Yes.
And have everybody in the same room, but different?
Uh-huh. Yeah, you probably could.
All right. Let's think it. Put that on the calendar. That'll be a really big you could put that on
the
calendar goal.
Since we don't know when the Rift is. We'd actually well, we should get
really
a dev
far in the calendar.
Should get a dev version of the Rift.
Yeah.
I don't know how you shoot that.
Yeah, I don't either, and that's what I really want. Like what I want to know is how what's the ecosystem, like the default ecosystem for a Rift. That's what I don't know.
What do you mean?
Well, so like, is there a baseline level location you can go to, or do you just play game?
There's no wander. All they have right now is a gallery, essentially, of things you can download and use the Rift for. But that's like saying, what's the ecosystem for a joystick or your monitor? Like, it's not meant to be an
ecosystem.
Someone
will create that ecosystem.
I don't know. Yeah, there'll be several ecosystems. Steam will be an ecosystem. Game consoles will be an ecosystem. PC gaming will be an ecosystem. You know, I guess Steam is PC gaming, but.
I guess I'm asking is, where is my Oasis? where is Oasis?
Well, somebody, that's what I'm trying to say is Oculus won't make that, but somebody might. And there actually might be more than one.
Yeah. That would be awesome. Then they could go to war.
Blizzard and Ultima and Second Life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but those Second Life people are just like hanging on, waiting for their
We're
Oculus.
Still here.
Hey, everybody. Yeah, that's my big exciting thing I'm waiting for. Okay.
I'm uploading things.
Things are being uploaded.
Should I make it public?
Yeah. I think you should.
You think so? All right.
I'm just all for advance notice.
I guess I'll make the file public.
Do it. I thought you were talking about the other thing, of the Gangs of Oculus. Ooh, that sounds good.
Gangs of Oculus. Sounds like an HBO show in the making.
Yeah. Warriors, put on your headsets. I saw James Remar on the one street in Hollywood, or actually in LA, where you can always see any celebrity any time of the day, sitting there, and I was like, oh my gosh, it's the guy from the Warriors, and I was so excited. And then I resisted screaming that in the middle of Larchmont Boulevard. And I thought that was very responsible of me. Warriors! So yeah, that was exciting. In one day, I saw Mark Fairstein, Schmidt from Real Girl.
Nice.
New Girl, not Real Girl. She's not a real girl. And James Remar. It was a pretty crazy day.
No
Eve
kidding.
Valkyrie. Okay. Oh, Eve, no. Oh, come on. Eve Online? I'll never be seen from again.
Isn't that what you want?
Yeah, but I still have to do my job, so I can't.
You're talking about the Oculus. Don't pretend like that's not going to be the same problem.
I know. It's really going to be a problem.
I used to think the same thing of Warcraft, actually. I was like, no, if I play it, I'll never stop. It wasn't true, actually. I could stop.
My interesting thing, though, is like I am not a big fan of the multiplayer because a multiplayer does what I do in real life, which is deal with people. I don't want to deal with people. I want to go deal in a world that has been created for me without other people, except Matt, who's like, do that, do that, do that.
No, I totally hear you. My thing with multiplayer, though, is like if you do it with people you know you like, it's really super fun.
That's true.
So you either have to treat the other player less like they're not people or find people that you want to be around, and then it's totally fine.
I mean, games in which you, like, I can't even be a bad guy for 5 minutes in these games. Like, I can't make immoral decisions in a video game. So like, the idea of actually trying to kill someone who was a real person and they're, I couldn't do it.
Yeah, no, you just got to forget there.
Couldn't do it.
They're not people in the video game.
That's not at all a problem for our society. Anyway, so that's why I stick to like the big online worlds that have no social interaction, unless it's with a robot. Oh, and how do we feel about Vince Vaughn being casted in True Detective with Colin Farrell?
I don't have a problem with that.
Okay.
Do you? I feel like that's a trick question.
No.
I feel like I'm supposed to have a problem with that, like it's a Ben Affleck in Batman sort of thing.
Well, I actually am a huge Ben Affleck fan and always have been, so I support all Affleckian things. But I actually have always been a fan of Ben Affleck ever since he wrote an article really, really early on in his career for like GQ or Esquire, and he was a damn good writer, and he had really good voice, and after that I was like, nope, he can't do any wrong. But yeah, I guess we'll see. I guess we should trust the people who make the thing.
All right, I'm out of the post.
All right.
Goodbye, video people. You are the best.
Bye.